Welcome here to the Air Crash Investigator. And this time around, I'm going to have a look at a catastrophic failure. And that means that the aircraft structurally came apart. Right. And this time, they suspect and they actually found that the culprit was aileron flutter. So let's go into that. But before we get our heels into that, just remember that Seams Aviation, they online, all right? So everything that you want to do, your CRM, DGs, all that kind of stuff is available online. Right. This guy out too, the picture that we're seeing here is the exact aircraft, the one that was in the accident and where the right wing actually broke off. Now, let's get into that. So first of all, I'm just going to get out of this here a little bit and say, where do we get the information? It's in the operating handbook, and it is amazing how many people don't really read through the whole handbook, especially when you want to do advanced stuff, such as aerobatics. It can do limited aerobatics, and it stipulates there very well what the limited aerobatics are. Now, you can't just stray over into the non-acceptables, because immediately doing that, you are going outside of the design specifications of this very specific aircraft. Not a good idea. Unfortunately, there's no way to see if the aircraft was flown outside its limits, and in this very case, as far as I could ascertain, it hasn't got a G-meter, and no, definitely not a G-meter that's got memory into to see what are the G-meters that were pulled. I think that's a good one that you must remember. If you've got an aircraft and you're going to let other people fly it and yourself and put yourself, get a G-meter and something that has got a little bit of a memory that you can see, because repeatedly overflying the aircraft in terms of G, V and E and stuff like that is a serious problem. Then we're looking at the aeroelasticity. Now, elasticity is no big deal. It's really just what it says. I've got a ruler here, and if this is the body of the aircraft, here we're talking about the wing is elastic. And you see a lot of times the big aircraft, when they fly, the wing starts going up like that, and they say, ooh, when is it going to snap? Obviously, it will get to a point where it will break. And where will it break? Right here, where there's no more elasticity to give. It can't, because it becomes too rigid. It's not elastic anymore at that point. But, all right. And then the last one on here says the balance of ailerons. Now, we are very specifically going to look at ailerons. I just want to show us something here. That's called the VN diagram. V for velocity, N for load factor, or the amount of G's that you pull, all right? And on it, it says, what is the maximum speed which you can do? What are the stalling in the G's that you can handle? And inside here, it gives you the flight envelope. Now, the flight envelope is within which you must have, but there is another limit in there, and there's a rolling G, which makes the flight envelope smaller. That is not information that you're going, that is advanced stuff. You're not going to get it in the KR2 book, okay? I'm not saying that happened. I'm saying that you must know about these things so that you can prepare yourself. I'm not going back. I want to look to the future so that we know what we're in for and that, you know, what we're going to do. The wing spar failure, the aircraft failure, right wing at the area where the failure occurred underneath the pilot seat. That's on the outboard side of the right-hand gear mount. This wing here is upside down. Okay, if I can put it, you've got to flip it towards yourself and over. There's the rear part of the spar. There's the main spar. Couldn't get to the tip to see that part. And ordinarily, one would think that this is a weak spot where they tied up, and it is not so. The weak spot is here. And remember, I specifically said that you wouldn't expect the wing, where it can still absorb through the elasticity any forces. whether it's in the twisting or the flapping moment, that's fine. But there where it cannot, that's where the failure normally or most probably could take place. So let's look at torsional flexural flutter. Torsional. So if you look at the wing from the side here, and there you can see I put in nicely, I said there's a torsional or elastic axis right in the center. Now in this picture here, the aileron goes down. That means the pilot wanted to turn to the left. So he pushed the stick to the left, the aileron goes down. The wing now wants to rise. But remember, this, it's got now a twisting force around the torsional axis. That will go to a specific point where there is, comes to its elastic stop. And I know, remember, it will go up against the stop, go down against the stop, up, down against the stop. And at a stage when it's at the stop and the force is too much, obviously that's when it's going to break. But here you can see in the last one. Now, if I clear that up, let's have a look, and you look at these two. The one has got a down-pitching moment and the one's got an up-pitching moment. And that is why the wing is in its length. It's doing this. It's moving in, around the torsional axis. Now, that was torsion. Now, let's get to flex. When it flexes up or down, all right? Remember, this is not called flutter. Flutter is merely the moment that it goes to the elastic stop, to the elastic stop, to the elastic stop, flips it back to the elastic stop. That's where the flutter part comes in. So the flexural flutter means this, and the torsional flutter means this. And torsional flexural flutter will mean the two together, and it will go up and down like this. Flexural aileron flutter is generally similar to that of the torsional aileron flutter, but it's caused by the movement of the aileron lagging behind the rise and fall of the wing. The aileron lagging. My goodness. So there's a kind of acceleration taking place. So for now, let's just, we've got a little bit of background, probability, lifespan sequence of the events leading up to this catastrophic event. And when I go through that, we've already spoken about it. Just a quick one to say, evidence. Well, we haven't got evidence of positive and negative, and we know that when we put on the ailerons, the load on those wings will either be higher or lower depending on the aileron going down or up at the moment in time. All right. Then there is elasticity will make it to twist around the torsional bar, all right? And the flutter means it goes against the stop and against the stop. And this is the moment that caused the flutter. All right. The twisting moment, torsional, there we've got it. There's one thing I just need to say, and that it is self-generating. In other words, think for yourself, if we would put it like this, if it gets to the stop, it will sort of like whip it back, and it goes to the stop, and it flashes it up, and now that builds a momentum. And then failure is normally at the point, and let me just open up there, where the stress force, it cannot be absorbed anymore. In other words, the elasticity is now gone, it's not elastic anymore, and in this body part here, that, and in the video that we're going to see, you'll see that one of the aircraft wing aerobatics where the wings snap, it is exactly the same as where this one snapped. We don't exactly know the reason for that. Rolling G? Whoa. All right. Now, there's two things happening here. First of all, you've got your pitching moments, which is your normal Gs. That'll give you your pitch up and pitch down, will give you positive and negative G, whatever G you want to do. But if you've got full aileron deflection, there will be a rolling stress as well. Now, just think for yourself, if you combine those two stresses, that means that as for, well, not as a rule, it is like that, that your maximum G limit let's say it was 4 G's. With a rolling G, it might then come down to like 3 G's or whatever the case may be. Now remember, you're not looking just at that. You're looking at VA. There's other stresses on other parts of the aircraft. And especially if you do aerobatics or advanced kind of aerobatics, this is what you get into. You get into full hard maneuvering and you never really worried about the rolling G limit because your aircraft is physically stressed for that. The KR, not. Am I pointing a finger? No, I'm trying to open it the mind that everybody that's flying an aircraft that is not specifically built for aerobatics. RV7 is not specifically built for aerobatics. So think about it, that you cannot get yourself into this trap. You cannot do advanced stuff with a normal aircraft. All right, so now we're just going to have a look at a few videos and we'll speak afterwards.
Well, having a look at this at the tail section, we're looking at the horizontal stabilizer attached to the elevator, and there you can see the flutter starting, and that is a torsional. You can see it goes up and around the torsional bar. Here we've got a glider, and we can see it's like the wing started flipping up and down, and that's flexural. So that's a flexural flutter. Right here we've just got serious stresses and strains. I think eventually the wings just came off under the hard work. Yeah, there we were just flying upside down and all of a sudden the wing departed. So we don't really know what he has done before that, but it looks like the wing was really seriously stressed at that moment in time and it just departed. Well, not something that we actually think that should have happened, but oh well, he walked away from this one.
Oh, welcome back. Yes, I think throughout there you could see, and why did I get in there with the C1 where the wings flipped off and stuff like that? You've seen that how many times? But do you know that how many times the wings went there? And if you're doing firefighting, there's the turbulence is unheard of. There's normally high winds, high vertical rising air, and obviously anything that goes up must go down. So, no, remember that Alclad and most of your other materials has got a memory. Then there are more modern materials that hasn't got a memory. All right, so the load factor limits must be respected. They're not there just... let's just say something about this. Normally, if you over-G the aircraft and it's made from sort of metallic, like Alclad and stuff like that, it will slightly bend, you will see something goes wrong. But once, if it's made of more modern sort of fiberglass and you know, that the advanced materials, then you will find that it will not show distortion. Those kind of wings will just go and snap. There's not going to be, stressed it, therefore it's slightly bent. It's not going to be a telltale sign for that one. All right. So V and E is never a suggestion, but a Steve, never to be exceeded. And what do we mean by that? Never means never. Yeah, but Charlie, you know, let's go for a loop. We're going to do V and E plus VAT. Now, VAT, VAT, value-added tax in South Africa, is plus 15%. So what this gentleman was telling me is that you go for V&E and you put another 15% on, and that is how you can do and reach the limits and the speeds required to do the aerobatics in the space that you're allowed to do that or should do that. That is so wrong that I've got no words. Yes, there is a small fudge factor, but V and E exactly is there to prevent for flutter or to be in an environment where flutter can be easily performed. Obviously, if you're going too fast down a tunnel, thing will break. I'm not talking about that. even before that, I'm talking in the beta limits, going up to the gamma limits, which is on the outside. In the inside, we fly in the alpha limit. And remember, because of rolling G limit, we've got a little bit of a shrunk alpha of envelope to fly the aircraft in. Anyway, probably too much, but rolling G is very complex. Always know what the aircraft is exposed to and never assume. There is just a big sentence, relative high speed plus load, adding aileron deflections. The point is that whatever we start off here with is self-generating, because as it reaches the top, it goes back and back, and this will go and increase. But it happens so fast that, and you've seen that. Now, in that first part of the video, what you didn't see is that the aircraft that was flying with to take what's going to happen with a flutter on the tail surfaces, the aircraft had to break away because it didn't know what's going to happen to the lead aircraft. Well, I can tell you now, there's nothing that could be done for the lead aircraft under those circumstances. Well, as I said, you must, you know, you have to know your aircraft. We've got so many aircraft, and then we start averaging out. And when you do low performance kind of stuff with all the aircraft, oh, they will all stick together and nothing will go wrong, and you won't break them. I'm just talking about now that you're going outside the limits and there's catastrophic structural failures. That's what I'm up to. So remember, if you're going to do aerobatics and advanced stuff, you better read the book. You must know what you're busy with. This accident may or may not have had any of the inputs that I've given you, but that the aircraft did develop flutter and that the ailerons were unbalanced outside its limits, that is a fact. That those were huge contributory facts, yes. Until next time.